Today, I would like to share some of the works which we have been doing in the past few years on robust statistic signal processing and machine learning for cyber-physical system reliability and resiliency with high penetration of distributed energy resources. So the here is the outline. I will introduce some of the key backgrounds behind the power system, especially in the cyber-physical systems, and also some of the key challenges we have to deal with when dealing with those problems. And also, I would like to share some of the research outcomes we have been doing in the past. And also, I would like to share some of the key insights in the future work we are doing now and we are going to do in a couple of years. So to start with, just a little bit more information about my research. Typically, my research here they can be categorized into the following major points. Here, the first one is the cyber-physical system, state and parameter estimation theory, and its application. And also the uncertainty quantification and mitigation. Those the first two terms they are general and they can be applied to any field. While I'm also a power engineer working in power system dynamic stability and cybersecurity, and also power distribution system visibility. And lastly, I have been doing a lot of work in robust statistic signal processing and machine learning applications. And to start with, I would like to emphasize the first challenge we have to deal with is, for example, in 1996, we had a major blackout in the western coast. The major reason behind that is the power system operators, they used to use their system model to plan and operate the system, but it turns out that there is a large discrepancy between the physical model responses and the data. That means the physical model is not always trustful. So you have to rely on the data as well. So this is the first challenge we have to deal with. The similar thing, in the 2003 Northeastern blackout, there is a strong issue behind the visibility of the systems. And in particular, during that hot summer, there was a topology error in the system. And that topology error triggered the divergency of the monitoring tool we have been using, which is a statistical meter. And without this statistical meter, we lack of the situation awareness of the system operation. And then also, that leads to the inappropriate protections and controls in the system. And finally, a large blackout happened in the system. So that means we have to really improve the situation awareness of the grid when we are operating the system. This is the similar thing for any cyber-physical system. You really need to have a good visibility for the system. And besides of the physical problems, we also have huge challenges from the cyber perspective. Here I'm showing you a particular example. You see, every day or every second, there are a lot of cyber intrusions from across the world. And in particular, in 2015, there was a very famous Ukraine cyber attacks, and the hacker hacked into the communication system and they shut down part of the cities, which is really causing a lot of impacts to the society. So we would like to detect those type of cyber attacks at the very beginning by relying on our physical information and other cyber information as well. So that means we have to deal with the cyber vulnerability as well. And to deal with the future grid, which we have been developing, and also today and future, as you can see, many countries across the world, they are trying to set a certain goal of choosing 100 carbon declination or carbon neutral solutions. And that means we are going to see a lot of renewable energy integration in the system. Renewable energy is good, they are clean, and you can extract a lot, but they also bring some certain challenges to the system operation, especially from the inertia or frequency perspective. This is the map showing the electrical vehicle integration and also the solar integration. In particular, for each state, as you can see here, you know, for Mississippi State, we only have 4.1% of solar penetration, but we do have a lot of you know, solar in our state. So I'm saying, you know, in the past or in the next 5 to 10 years, we are going to see the tremendous integration of solar energy, and that will change the paradigm of generation mix. And to do that, you know, due to those stochasticity and uncertainties from the energy resources, it's very difficult to predict what will be really the demand from the system are. And this is the curve from the California ISO saying that, you know, there are really a challenging of getting, you know, sufficient, you know, reserve once the sun is down, while you need to ramp up the generations of available energy resources in a very short time period. This causes a lot of challenges, and this is the fact we have to deal with. And from the, you know, 2012 to 2020, you see the dark curve is becoming more and more sharp. And this is the challenge we have to address as well. And then, you know, to further elaborate, you know, with the high penetration of renewable energy, especially in some of the countries, here I'm giving you the South Australia, this part, and they have really high penetration of renewable energy. And there was an event happened in the system, and due to the lack of inertia, we see a significant frequency of the system, and that triggers the cascading failure. And you know, this indicates a high demand of frequency, you know, of stability tools we have to develop. And to deal with those challenges is also very good to have a lot of data. And since 2009, the North America has been developing a lot of, you know, high precision synchronized you know, measurement devices. And for example, here we have 2,500 PMUs deployed throughout the system. You know, those PMUs are going to provide you a lot of situational awareness and also help you to you know, to handle some model issues. But still, you know, as long as these are data, the data are communicated through the communication channels, they may induce some impulsive noise or bad data, as we see, you know, they certainly have some data quality issues. That means the tools we're developing, they have to be robust to the data quality issues. And the data quality is also one very important thing we have to do to deal with whether you are developing machine learning applications. And that is a pre-processing, but that does not mean all data processing can handle well the bad data. So you need robustness to deal with that. So to summarize, you know, our system is going to have a lot of you know, great uncertainties, either from the cyber side or physical side, and also from the resources perspective, we have you know, load and DER uncertainties, right? And here, you know, just a replay of the previous story about you know, blackout, and also, you know, from the load and the renewable energy as well here. So here to deal with that, those challenges, you know, from the physical model perspective, you know, for a physical model, you have load and distributed energy resources, parameters to describe the system. Your model is not always perfect. You have a lot of uncertainties. So you have to mitigate all those uncertainties when you are trying to simulate and to get insights of the system. So, and also for that, you have to incorporate the data inside this physical loop so that you can have a clever decision when planning and operating the system. And you know, to have data, we certainly have a lot of data in power system domain. And you know, here, this is the map showing the smart meters every residential customers may have. And also this is going to increase. As I see a lot of news, they are, you know, for each state, they start to adopt the smart meters. And also besides the power system domain itself, we also have a lot of off-domain data. For example, traffic, the GIS, weather, or other type of you know, image data. And those are very helpful for us in power system domain to do a lot of analysis and to improve the reliability and the resiliency of the system. So really, in summary, we need better models so that we can we can plan the system, we need a dynamic visibility so that we know what is really going on, you know, on time. And also, once you have visibility, you have to predict and make things secure. And also, if there is something that can cause insecure condition, you have to control that, right? So this can be showed in this loop. So you have data, you also have model. From the model, you can get the operating states of any cyber-physical system, which is the visibility. And since our model has issues, our model simulations always has a gap in the data. So if there is anything about the states, if you do not have a good visibility of the system, you are trying to estimate the system states. If there's anything about your system model, you are trying to see if I can improve our physical model. And also, due to the data quantity issue, there might be bad data or unreliable data. You have to repair those data. With the data validation, calibration of the model, and visibility of the system, and then, of course, you can have a more reliable, secure, and resilient system for the future, right? And to deal with those challenges, we believe the robust statistics and the machine learning techniques, they can certainly provide a lot of help. So, following these guidelines and to, solve some of the challenges, we have, casted our work into the three main themes. And in summary here that, the key idea behind you have model, always you have, model response. But in the meantime, you have sensor. So the key idea is that how we are going to combine the physical model response and the data together so that you can have more, clever decision and visibility and controllability. And at the end, you have a more reliable, secure, and resilient system. So to deal with those, from the modeling perspective and visibility perspective, we have developed some theoretical framework for any cyber-physical system, robust, dynamic state and parameter estimation. And for the operation of the, grid, we have been working on the next generation of energy management systems for cyber grid multi-scale resiliency and reliability. And from the, security and uncertainty, perspective, we have been doing a lot of AI techniques to help us have a better predictive capability and also preventive control, capabilities. So I'm going to elaborate on some of those, three main, things we have been doing in the past. So to the first, it starts with, a general framework for cyber-physical system state and parameter estimation. And the key idea is that relying on the robust statistics theory, we have been developing several theoretical filters. They can be, common filter family. Either it is a linear common filter or nonlinear common filter, or within the Bayesian framework. The idea is that, as we said before, the data may have non-Gaussian noise. They have bad data. They also have cyber attacks, concerns, as we discussed before. So within the robust statistics and the command filter framework, we have been developing really some robust techniques to handle all those type of challenges. But in the meanwhile, we have been thinking about those techniques are really good in dealing with these large deviations. How about those small deviations from the model or from the data? And then we have to resort to the robust control theory, and they help us to bound the influences from the small perturbation. And for that, we have developed some H-infinity filters. Those can help us deal with parameter errors, unknown inputs, and various sources of uncertainties. Again, once we finish that, we see, the H-infinity is very good for small deviations, and robust these are very good for large deviations. Can we combine those two, different theoretical frameworks together? So that we can have an integrated solution for both problems. Yes, we can. Under the a new space, which we we call it clean space. And then we can combine those two. Actually, we can cast the H infinity filter into a, you know, a regression or common filter type. And for that, we show that the H infinity UKF is exactly the least square estimator in the clean space. And because of that, it does not have any robustness to the you know, to the Lambda-Gaussian noise or bad data stains. Then we resort to the robust statistics so that we, instead of using the least squares, we use the robust techniques in the clean space. And then we developed the so-called hybrid robust techniques. And this is, you know, some theoretical work. We have been publishing those works in IEEE transaction and single processing, you know, journals. Those are demonstrating the theoretical, you know, works we have been doing in the past. And since I'm also a power engineer, so I have applied those theoretical frameworks to help us solve power engineering problems. For example, here, we have been applying those techniques for general state or parameter estimation, which I'm going to show you a couple of use cases. And also those, you know, tools that can help us, you know, do a better stability assessment and control of the power grid as well. And that, you know, data quality detection and mitigation, those are lateral byproducts of those robust, you know, framework. So let's first talk about the parameter estimation use cases here. You know, due to those, you know, limitation of this presentation time, I cannot go through really to the theoretical works. So if you are interested in, you can go to my website and see some of the theoretical work on the, you know, cyber-physical system state of parameter estimation. Here, I will focus specifically on the power system, you know, use cases. So first use case is about the model validation and calibration. This is a general tool for any cyber-physical model you are using, okay? And here, specifically, we are dealing with the power plant. You know, we are measuring some of the terminal quantities, and then we play back through the physical model, and then we have input, outputs, and then in the meanwhile, the outputs are measured by sensors. So we compare it with the model responses and the measured, you know, sensors. And then if there is a large gap, we see, oh, the physical model has some deficiency. We have to help you calibrate this model. And to find those problematic parameters, we have to develop some advanced sensitivity analysis techniques. For example, here we are using, you know, some local sensitivity analysis tools, and also we have been developing the global sensitivity analysis tools to help us correctly identify those problematic parameters of your physical model. And once you have found those problematic parameters, you are trying to augment those parameters into the, you know, estimation loop so that you can find the new parameter sets for the physical model. And then after that, you enter to the validation stage, which here, as you can see, if there is no calibration loop in here, there is a large gap between the actual responses and the model responses. You see the original model, the blue one is still far away from the red one, right? They are really far away. And then once the calibration is done, then we can get quite a good you know, a match. And this applies to other you know, type of events as well. You simulate different conditions and you see they find the parameters, they are good to go with many different conditions. So this is the first application, and this has been adopted by you know, some commercial companies such as GE. And still we are collaborating with Pacific Northwest Western Lab to see if we can incorporate the parameter estimation module into their software. Another application is that, you know, a physical model can be quite complicated. You know, this might be the case for some power system application. And here we use the power plant as an example. You know, for a physical model, you can try to model it as detailed as possible. But the thing is that it's very difficult to get those detailed and accurate models. So, but for some applications, you don't need to use really the full physical model. You may just use part of it. while treating other parts as unknowns. So by using the framework there, you can treat some of the parts of the system you don't want to use as unknown inputs in the estimation loop. And from there, you have the original state variables, and then you treat the other parts as unknowns into the joint estimation problems. And from there, you can estimate the interested variables for you without using the detailed model. And by using that, we can use those type of techniques to help you validate the external model problems. For example, here, we have been using just this generator model while treating all the control loops as unknowns, the control outputs as unknowns. Once you estimate those control outputs, and then you can rely on the, you know, for each control loop, they have their, you know, respective models, right? So using that model, you get the output. In the meanwhile, you have estimated the outputs. You compare if there's any major differences. If there are, and then that means your physical model also have some issues. And especially during online applications, you may find, oh, there might be a failure for some of the controls, you know, of the system. You can quickly locate, and this is quite helpful for device level diagnostic in many engineering applications. But here I'm just showing you the power plant applications. And another application which is quite useful for distribution company, and you know, during hot summer or during some winter time, the customers, they are starting to use a lot of electricity from the grid. They are using a lot of air conditioner or heating devices, right? So they are consuming a lot of you know, electricity. From the utility perspective, probably this is a really challenging to handle. So they are figuring out if there is any energy saving they can do. And typically the conservation water reduction is one very useful applications behind. The key idea is that by assess the sensitivity between the load changes, the customer electricity changes, to the, you know, voltage changes. So by doing that, or to have that information, you have to model the customer behaviors. And from that perspective, it is just a load modeling problem. And load modeling problem can be casted as a parameter estimation problem. And from there, especially in that parameter estimation problem is a time varying. So it is varying from time to time. So by using the framework we have developed before, we can track the variations of the parameters, and then you get the real-time sensitivity information. And once you have that, utilities can feel free to implement and identify those failures for energy saving. And we have used some, you know, field data from the Western United States, and we found that during hot summer, especially here June and July, we can have really good deal of energy savings during those times. And this is another useful application for the theoretical framework. Another you know, very useful application, again, is related to the parameter estimation. And from the circuit analysis perspective, you know, when you are trying to study, for example, you know, in stock wall, you know, you are trying to increase the electricity demand from the grid. The question is that, what is the maximum electricity you may have without causing any issues for the system operation? And this is related to the voltage stability or system stability perspective. And to deal with that, we can see, okay, this is stock wall, you know, load center, and we model it as a demand. We load that, and we know probably we need to increase that and see what is going to happen. But for the external system, you have no idea, right? Because that is managed by the utility. So to have that information, you are trying to figure out what would be the external system. So we do a semi equivalent for the external system. And once you have the semi equivalent information, you start to see what is the maximum power you can get from the system without causing any issues. And this one, semi equivalent estimation, or, you know, or judgment here, is related to the parameter estimation as well. And by using the previous framework, you can also you know, easily achieve this goal you know, by identifying those time varying parameters. So you see, you know, really some many applications I mentioned here, they are, you can find in many engineering fields, because the theory itself or theoretical framework is quite general. And here, we're just showing you the engineering applications. And another very useful application, which are going to be seen in the future power system, is that we are going to have a lot of solar. And in 2016 in California, they are facing a lot of wildfire issues. And those wildfires, they may cut off some of the transmission lines. And the outage of the transmission lines will induce a lot of disturbances to the system, especially the frequency. But unfortunately, the phase lock loop, by measuring the frequency is not reliable. And this is evident, in the North American reliability coordination community. And we realize the existing tools, they could not provide you the useful frequency information once there's a large disturbance. And this is really because, the existing PMU or PIL loop, they are trying to take the derivative respect of the phase angle respect to time t, but the phase angle can be suddenly changed because it is an algebraic variables. And to deal with that, we are trying to figure out another clever estimation module, because here for every bus frequency, it can be determined by a few synchronous generator rotor speed, and those rotor speed they have inertia associated with that. That means they do not have any sudden changes. So by using that property and using the dynamic state estimation tools we have developed, we can try to estimate the bus frequency. And this can help us solve those solar integration problems in the future. And we are going to see this will going to be very useful in the future power electronics dominated system. And up to now, I have shared a couple of applications behind this theoretical framework. In the next theme, we are going to elaborate about cyber physical system, typically from monitoring and machine learning applications here. So to summarize, so for any cyber physical power systems, we have a lot of data. Also, we have a lot of uncertainties, as we elaborated at the very beginning, and we are trying to see under the new environment, what would the energy management system would be in the future, right? So by studying that, we're trying to propose some of the new monitoring tools or modules. We're seeing the EMS 2.0 monitoring tool, security and control tool, and optimization tools. So I'm going to elaborate more on those application side as well. So the first one is about the visibility of the grid. Remember, at the beginning we have been emphasizing a lot the visibility for the system, and the visibility here in the existing power industry, they are relying on a static tool, static view. They update the system operating states every 2 or 5 seconds. While if there's large disturbances happen in the system, and then they do not capture those dynamic changes. So we realize we need dynamic tools to monitor what's going on if there's a large or unexpected changes in the system. So we have developed the event detection module, and if there's any system event detected, we are going to switch from static tool to a dynamic tool, which is here is a dynamic state meter, and then we start to monitor the system and operate and control and see if the system can be safely damped out. And once everything is back to normal, and then we can switch back again to the static tool that existing EMS has. And then we have really a visibility from the static operating states toward the dynamic states of the system. And this we have been doing with, also working now with G and MISO to make sure it is commercial integration, and hopefully this can be done in the next couple of years. And another application, remember here we have an event detecting module, event driven module here, and to have event besides of detecting anomalies in the system operating, we would like to know which type of, you know, events it is, right? Because, you know, for different type of events, you may have different actions to take to avoid those problems. So to deal with that, we have been developing some machine learning tools based on the, you know, historical data or some of the simulation data. We have extracted the key features and build up the libraries that matches well with each type of, you know, event types. Once the new data is coming, we are going to compare the extracted feature library and to help us locate which type of event it is. This can help us deal with any, you know, immediate or emergent actions you may take to avoid any unnecessary problems. So here, this is the first, you know, very useful machine learning application in power system. And also, you know, in this application, we assume the data, they are of good quality, right? But, you know, at the introduction, I have shown you that our, you know, data certainly have a lot of quality issues. So to deal with the data quality issues when using machine learning techniques, we are trying to just extract the essential feature. Here we are using the autoencoders just to extract the latent space variables, and based on the latent, you know, state variables, we are trying to know what are the key or essential features we should maintain, and also make sure those are of high quality. And once that is done, we can also, you know, based on some you know, convolutional networks to help us better extract those features, and also build the modules of identifying and classifying different type of events. And this is the enhanced version of the previous, you know, techniques here. So there's a second, you know, enhancement for this type of application. And also, you know, remember our, you know, framework in power system, because you see power engineers or some physical systems, they are always trying to rely on their models for operation and control. And data-driven, purely data-driven is not really the tool we should use in those critical infrastructure operation. So that means we have to incorporate some of the physics, especially those physical constraints, into our machine learning module. And this is motivated by some of the informed machine learning and community. And you know, motivated by that, I start to build some of the physics-informed you know, machine learning techniques to help us, you know, reduce their searching space when we are trying to find a relationship between the input and output, and also trying to help us improve the, you know, explainability of the results. Because for engineering applications, you really need to know, you know, what I can expect from the machine learning model. And black box or data-driven based black box model is very difficult to predict, you know, what would be happen in the next. So we have, you know, been doing some of the physics informed machine learning techniques to deal with the, you know, optimal power flow in power system, you know, operation. And also, you know, here, this is a deterministic problem. We have also been extending that to our, you know, chance constrained problem. Chance constrained means that no matter what you do, there is a certain probabilities of violating some of the constraints, some physical constraints. But the thing is that you don't want those violations to be high probability. So you are going to limit the violation of the constraints into a certain point. For example, you just allow maximally 5% of violating certain you know, physical constraints, while without causing a lot of you know, economical damages or other type of operational problems. And this can certainly happen in practical system. For example, here in MISO system, they typically they do a day ahead load forecasting, which here they would like to know what would be the load consumptions in the next day, right? And it turned out in some of the, you know, cases, they have a large predicting gaps. You know, for example, here it's approximately 3,100 megawatts error, which is huge. And this will certainly cause some of the violations for the constraints. And, you know, to model those type of very difficult problems, we are trying to see if we can use machine learning techniques. Here, we are using specifically Gaussian process to model the probabilities of violating that physical constraint, but trying to limit the violation into a certain level of percentage. For example, here we are setting 5%. And you know, once you have that machine learning-based representation for the chance constraint, and then you use the original physical model as well as other constraints to solve the problem, and then you can come up with a solution. So you know, machine learning here, they also help us to deal with very difficult constraints, especially in those stochastic constraints in the optimization problem. And we found that it is really providing us very useful and also feasible solutions for those type of difficult problems as well. Another application we have been seeing also is very important is that from the any dynamic system, they can be represented by differential and algebraic equations. So if you have any uncertainties on your differential and algebraic equations, the simulation outputs will have the uncertainties. And in the past, people are trying to use the Monte Carlo simulations to quantify what would be the uncertainties from the input to output. But the thing is that Monte Carlo is nice. They can handle any scenarios, but it's too time consuming. They could not satisfy the online application requirements we are having, especially for power engineering applications. So we have been trying to develop some of the polynomial chaos space expansion or some of the machine learning or numerical Gaussian process based techniques to trying to propagate the uncertainties from the inputs to the dynamic outputs. And this is very useful. And this has been, those type of concepts has been, widely used in fluid dynamics and also other physics. And this will hold for many cyber-physical systems, including the power system here as well. And here, still, there are a lot of works we need to do from the power engineering perspective, because we do have some discrete changes in the system. And this can cause a lot of challenges to model the responses from that scenario. But anyway, those are the some of the capabilities the next generation of EMS they should have in handling the the multi-scale monitoring, handling uncertainties, and also the large-scale optimization problems with very difficult constraint to model. And the third one we would like to elaborate, the same we would like to elaborate, is the cyber-physical grade security with uncertainties. Here we are going to really focus on the security perspective. Either it is a stability issue or cybersecurity issue or preventive control problems we are trying to solve. And again, here we have been relying a lot of data, because our model, they could not really reflect all the system characteristics. So we are trying to get help from the data and trying to combine those two sources of information so that we can have better capability of predicting assessment and preventive control. So to first start with, in the past, when you are trying to assess the system, if it is secure or not, then you're trying to run the simulation or you're trying to use some determinist techniques to say, oh, my system is secure or not. It's a binary decision, right? Nowadays, since there are many different parts, they could not be modeled in an accurate manner. So you have uncertainties in your outputs or your decisions you are receiving. So here, typically, for example, here for power system application, you have a stability. In the past, we are using the mean of the, which is a red dot here, to say, okay, our system is secure. But with uncertainty, you see you are going to have a certain space. There are certainly some probabilities you are going to violate the system stability, right? So by using some of the advanced machine learning techniques or uncertainty propagation techniques, you can certainly judge and tell the operators how much or what is the probability of violating the system stability. You know, you can give that number. If the number, for example, there are just 1% of violating the system stability, you may say, oh, I don't care too much about that. But if there are 5 or 10%, then you have to pay attention to that and do appropriate planning, you know, of avoiding those type of issues. So you see, this is really helpful from the, you know, advanced static signal processing and machine learning techniques to help us solving those, you know, very complicated engineering problems. The similar thing, you know, when you are trying to predict if the system is going to be secure or not, you know, instead of just having a one single value, we are always trying to bring up from the probabilistic perspective to tell you, you know, the interval of the outcome we are bringing up here. You know, so from the total capability perspective, and total capability perspective is really about the system. You are, you know, for a large system, it is connected, interconnected with several other systems. We would like to know what would be the maximum power we can carry through those tie lines. Because if there's any emergency in the internal system, you have to rely on the external resources, right? So you would like to assess what would be the maximum power we can get from those external systems. And this can help you to have a better plan of defending those scenarios. And here, we can use the advanced probabilistic, you know, machine learning techniques to give you an interval. You know, what would be the maximum power you may expect the upper level and the, you know, lower level of those values, okay? And followed by this prediction, you may say, oh, I have really a certain 10% probability of violating the system stability. Then you may wondering, you know, how I can, you know, schedule my system so that I can avoid this type of problems. So to deal with that here, you know, you have already built up this preventive models, right? So for preventive control, which is optimization problems, and you know, if you are using a black box model from the machine learning here, which is a black box predictive model, and then you have the regular mathematical equations, then it's really difficult to adopt the classical mathematical, you know, classical mathematical optimization problem techniques to solve that problem. So to deal with those type of challenges, we have developed two main, you know, strategies. The first one is that, okay, you have black box constraints, you have the normal, you know, mathematical constraints, and that is fine. You know, you know, you can use the evolutionary machine learning evolutionary or heuristic optimizing problem, because for the black box model, you give the inputs, you have the outputs. So you are generating a lot of inputs, and then you get a lot of outputs to evaluate the objective function, and then you select the best out of it. So this can help you address the black box issues from the machine learning when solving the you know, optimization problem. This is the first strategy. The second strategy we are trying to develop is that, you know, instead of you know, instead of using a heuristic optimization to deal with the black box problems, then we are asking ourselves if we can open the black box model. You know, remember for the traditional mathematical based you know, optimization techniques, we need to know the gradient of the constraints or the Hessian matrix of the gradient of the constraints. So you know, from motivated by that, we see, okay, for example, you have a deep neural networks, you know, constraints, which is learned from the historical data or some other type of resources. So you have that black box model. Can we derive theoretically the gradient, which is a Jacobian matrix and the Hessian matrix from that? Once you have that information, you can feel free to use the integer optimization techniques, which is quite classical to solve optimization problem. And in some of the latest work, we have you know, achieved this goal by deriving theoretically from the deep neural networks model the Jacobian matrix and also the Hessian matrix. And the Jacobian matrix, they are quite nice to help you, provide the sensitivity information when you are trying to select or control certain variables. While the Hessian matrix, they allow you to combine together with the original classical optimizing problem for solving. And we are very happy to see this technique is working pretty well in solving the black box type of constraints in the optimization problem. And I hope those two really interesting solution methodologies, they can be recognized in other fields as well. We first developed those techniques and published in the power engineering field because we see some of the values. Certainly, this can be applied to other areas, for example, computer science or industry system engineering problems. They do have this type of problem as well. And also, the last piece I would like to mention here is from the cybersecurity perspective. Our power system is essentially a cyber physical system. We have a lot of physical devices in the field. In the meanwhile, to communicate with different parts of the system, we need communication channels, either through the sensors or some of the wireless or optic fiber optics communications, so on and so forth. So that means there are a lot of communication points that can be compromised by the hackers. So our idea is that because we have physical systems, we know the physics behind it, and data is fine. They are capturing those physics, right? So by relying on the physical information, can we infer if there are any issues for the data, or our data, since they are capturing the spatial and temporary correlation of the physical grid, if we can use those physical spatial temporal correlations to help us identify the potential cyber attacks in the data as well. So here I'm giving you just one widening research topic in the power system, and this can be seen in other computer science as well. The false data injection attack, and this is quite clever, because they can inject the data to a certain subregion, which is a small error, and those power injections, false data injection attacks, they are designed in a manner that the traditional tools, they could not diagnose it, and this can be causing huge issues for the system operation. And some people have demonstrated that through those type of cyber attacks, there can be overloading of some of the transmission lines that can be causing security constraints for the system operators. And to deal with that, we have derived some of the theoretical upper bounds for launching such successful cyber attacks, because from the cyber hacker's perspective, they have to know certain local information, but those local information, they may not be accurate enough for them to have a perfect cyber attack. So the question is that for system operator, how much uncertainties they should have without being catched, caught by the system operator. So we have derived certain bounds showing that about a certain level of uncertainties, if they are beyond those uncertainty level, they can successfully launch those cyber attacks. If they are going beyond, they can be easily diagnosed by the system operator. And also, to detect those type of cyber attacks, we are relying on the spatial and temporary correlations between our data and also the physical model. And here we are using just a simple autoregression regression, which is a vector autoregression model to help us extract the spatial and temporary correlation of the system. And then we compare the consistency and make sure everything is consistent. If not, and then we see there are potential cyber attacks. And also, we are using the adversary machine learning techniques to train and also to come up with some of the defense techniques so that we can align detection of those cyber attacks. And this is very interesting, and we will continue to investigate this direction. So up to now, I think I have provided an overview of the three main themes we have been talking before. So looking into the future, there are a couple of directions we would like to go. The first one is always because our system is becoming more and more complicated. And to handle such a complicated system, we need visibility, we need better model. And the single phasors, they are providing you a lot of helpful information. But still, there are a lot of questions we have to clearly address. For example, we have to deal with the frequency stability, as we mentioned before, and also we have to design some automatic control techniques and big data issues for the single phasor applications as well. So this is really one major direction we are going forward. Another thing is that our system is going to see a lot of Internet of Things of devices in the grid. Those are the small distributed energy resources or smart homes, smart buildings, and they are producing a lot of data. And also, we are wondering in the future, instead of having large power generations at the transmission side, we are going to have a lot of small DERs, and they are trying to provide electricity to the communities. So we are wondering if we can, through the advanced communication channels, as well as advanced control techniques, to coordinate different devices, either at the commercial building, residential building, and together with the utilities, so that we can achieve a more clever leverage of the available resources as well. And also from the distribution or from the customers to the utilities or box systems, there can be two-way communications. The transmission system operator, they can inform those small devices. They say, oh, I need some help from you guys. Can you respond and help us do a better job of securing the system grid, the system operation? So you see there, really, we are going to deal with the grid of things. Instead of Internet of Things, we see a grid of things in the future. And that needs a lot of efforts from mining the data and coordinating and large scale optimization and control problems. And from there, we see a lot of potential for the machine learning and big data analytics applications. And followed by that, for example, to give more detail at the distribution side, we do have multi-fidelity data, low fidelity or high fidelity data. So how we are going to merge different fidelity of the data resources and synchronize all those data to have to give us a better visibility of the system. And here, the core idea is that we need to make sure the data is converging together with the model, or the model is converging together with the data, so that we can have really a good visibility and resiliency of the system. And there are a lot of applications behind those data model convergence. And we see this is really the way we should go for some engineering applications. We should not fully trust the model. We should not fully trust the data. We should try to combine. We should try to combine the data and together with the model, so that we can have a better explainability of from the data, and also to make a better compromise between the two resources. And this is really the idea I have been pursuing, and also I will continue to push forward for cyber physical system applications. And that's all I have for today's presentation, and thank you very much for listening.